All right, so now let's focus in on the alpha herpes virus as our model organism to think about persistence. And we're going to talk basically for the remainder of the lecture about just this one group of viruses. First of all, I want to introduce the alpha herpes viruses to you and explain what they are. I then want to talk about how the immune system controls viral infections. You have to understand that first before you can understand what the virus is doing to derail that process. So then we'll talk about the countermeasures, the immune evasion factors that a herpes simplex virus makes in order to derail the immune response so it can persist. Not only can it persist, it can reactivate, or that is, it can come out of latency and reactivate and spread and be transmitted to other people or cause recurrent disease. And finally, we'll wind up with the paradox of recurrent herpes as it was presented, 30 or 40 years ago before we really understood exactly what was happening. All right, so alpha herpes viruses, who are the players? So herpes viruses as a group are an evolutionarily ancient group of viruses. They're pretty much present in every species that has a backbone. We know of 130 different examples of herpes viruses, okay? Anything from chickens to kangaroos to crocodiles, even oysters. Okay, these are old viruses. All of the herpes viruses always make infectious particles that look like what you see over here. There's basically a capsid or a nucleocapsid containing DNA in the center that's moved from one cell to another, and there's an envelope that surrounds it. They all look like that. It doesn't matter whether you pulled that herpes virus from an oyster or a human being, they all look the same. At the core of the herpes viruses, they all have a set of 42 genes that make these little packages, and they also make the machinery to replicate the viral DNA. They all establish lifelong infections in their host. They all can remain latent for a long period of time, and they all reactivate episodically to make new infectious particles that can be transmitted to the next organism. In the case of humans, there are 8 human herpes viruses. We broadly divide these into those herpes viruses that use neurons as their permanent home. And we call those neurotropic herpes viruses alpha herpes viruses. Specifically, we're talking about herpes simplex virus type 1 and 2, and the closely related varicella zoster virus that causes chickenpox and a primary infection, and when it reactivates from latency, it causes zoster or shingles. Okay. Then, once we get beyond those alpha herpes viruses, all the other human herpes viruses infect white blood cells. Some of them infect monocytes or macrophage, like cytomegalovirus, human herpes viruses 6 and 7. Other of these blood-borne herpes viruses, the gamma herpes viruses, infect lymphocytes. Epstein-Barr virus likes B lymphocytes. Human herpes virus 8 likes T lymphocytes. Okay, alpha herpes viruses, neurons. Beta herpes viruses, monocytes. Gamma herpes viruses like lymphocytes. Now, if we focus in on the alpha herpes viruses, just the ones that infect neurons, which is what we'll be talking about for the remainder of the lecture. One of the most common examples that most people are familiar with is that HSV-1 is the cause of oral herpes. Okay. During the primary infection with herpes simplex virus type 1, basically what it does, it gets into the skin, undergoes a replication or amplification cycle. Some of that amplified virus is not only spreading across the skin, it's actually getting into the nerves that send nerve fibers to the skin, and it is carried back up those nerve fibers by a pretty elaborate process called retrograde axonal transport, and it reaches the nucleus of the neuron up here in a collection of nerves that is called the ganglia, in this case the trigeminal ganglion. It's just basically a collection of neurons surrounded by support cells. Later in life, so let me back up, the difference between the infection in the skin and the infection of the neurons is the immune system can control the infection in the skin and completely clear the virus. The infection of the neurons is lifelong. It lasts a human lifetime. So that is where the latent infection is established, up in the neurons of the peripheral nervous system. Later in life, that latent infection can reactivate and the infectious virions can be carried back down the nerve fibers by the opposite process, anterograde axonal transport, reach the skin and reinitiate a new recurrence of oral herpes. In the case of herpes simplex virus type 2, the life cycle is remarkably similar. Typically, we associate herpes simplex virus type 2 with genital herpes. Again, a primary infection is established in the skin of the penis or in the mucosal epithelium of the vagina. Let me emphasize at this point, HSV-1 can also cause genital herpes, so there's really no strict barrier here that restricts HSV-1 to the mouth and HSV-2 to the genitals. It's just that, statistically speaking, most people that have oral herpes, it's caused by HSV-1. Most people that have, about half of people that have genital herpes, it'll be caused by HSV-2. The other half will be caused by HSV-1. The biology is really similar. Anyway, in the case of HSV-2, we get replication in the epithelium. Again, virions are carried back up the nerve fibers to the ganglia that send nerve fibers down there, in this case, the sacral ganglia of the lower spine. And there the virus will hang out for a human lifetime. Later in life, if that latent virus reactivates, it could send infectious virions back down to where it came in, and you can get recurrences of lesions. And typically in the case of herpes simplex virus, for people to get recurrent lesions, they do keep coming back to the exact same sites over and over, which suggests that the neurons that are supporting the reactivation events are not killed. The reason the reactivation events keep happening the same site in the skin is that it's probably the same neuron sending the virus back down there repeatedly. So then we come to varicella zoster virus. Now it gets a little bit different. Very related biology, but HSV-1 and HSV-2 tend to cause recurrences in the exact same locations over and over. Varicella zoster virus is a little bit different. Varicella zoster virus during a chickenpox outbreak is typically spread by a respiratory route. That is, a sick person coughs up droplets loaded with the virus, another person breathes them in, enters the lungs, and from there, varicella zoster virus can enter the bloodstream. That is, it can infect T cells. It can also infect the nerves that go to the lungs. And so you've got spread both through the nervous system as well as the bloodstream, which is why the lesions go all over the whole body. It's a systemic infection. As far as what happens with latency, all the ganglia in the body are susceptible to varicella zoster virus. Since it's going everywhere, you can have latent varicella zoster virus everywhere from the trigeminal ganglia down to the lower spine. Everything is fair game. Chickenpox, while it tends to cause this very systemic infection all over the place, if you're talking about people who are unvaccinated who are exposed, when it goes latent, it can also reactivate, which tends to happen late in life, people in their 50s, 60s, 70s. When it reactivates, it typically only reactivates in a single ganglion. But unlike herpes simplex that causes a lesion at one spot, every neuron in that ganglion winds up supporting varicella zoster virus replication. So you tend to get a cluster of lesions that basically is a map of where that dermatome or where that the dermatome of that ganglia, that is the area innervated by that ganglia. So what that looks like is here in this individual, probably a ganglia somewhere around here in the spine sent virus down to everywhere that ganglia sent nerve fibers to. In this individual, a ganglia down the lower spine sent the reactivated virus all over here. And sometimes it happens up to people's face where the latent virus reactivates out of the trigeminal ganglia and comes down across the whole face. You'll notice that typically it is unilateral. Typically, it's when shingles happens, it's only on one side of the body and it stops precisely in the midline, because the left ganglia only send nerve fibers to the left half of the body and the right ganglia only send nerve fibers to the right half of the body. So clearly the virus, the way it's getting down to the skin, is through the ganglia, and in this case, not through the bloodstream. It's not going everywhere. So if we think about all three of these viruses as a whole and just lump them together, they're all establishing latency in neurons, and they all seem to provoke an immune response that you can actually see at the site of latency. A little bit like Mycobacterium tuberculosis, not as profound as a granuloma caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but very similar in what you see. That is, you see T cells that are activated, that are making molecules such as interferon gamma that are known to suppress the replication of this virus when you put it together with other cytokines of the immune response. And that seems to actually be keeping the virus in a non-replicating state. So typically when we think of T cells coming in and interacting with viruses, we think of a CD8 T cell or a cytotoxic T cell coming and literally killing the virus-infected cell. That does not seem to happen in herpes simplex virus. This neuron, as is typical of any neuron that you see in an animal, a human or an experimental animal, when it's surrounded by T cells, the neurons look quite healthy. If the cytotoxic T cells were actually in the process of killing a cell, it would just look like an abnormal cell. It would look like it was dying. We don't see that. So the response that controls this infection seems to be non-cytolytic is the term. It's just keeping the infection contained, but it's not killing the infected cell. So here, quite literally, if we come back to our equilibrium, in the case of herpes simplex virus, it looks like combinations of interferon gamma and another set of innate cytokines called interferon alpha beta actively seem to work together and capable to push this piece of DNA, the latent, the viral DNA, towards a state of inactivity. And the thing that seems to tip the balance back towards replication are proteins that come from these long repeated regions of the genome shown as kind of empty white boxes. These activators tend to make the virus way more interferon resistant and able to overwhelm the immune response that's trying to contain it and push it back towards replication. A lot of the stimuli that are known to reactivate HSV from latency are known to wake up the ICP0 gene. Okay, so it, again, not just graphically in equilibrium, but in reality, it appears to be in equilibrium. All right, so those are the players. We talked about alpha herpes virus. So let's talk about the basic biology of herpes simplex virus. So the virus itself, unlike some viruses, is just too large to really discuss in a gene-by-gene fashion. There are 75 genes. If you go through and have a list of those genes, it's just too long to go through gene-by-gene. So what we do is we tend to group these genes functionally together into three groups. The first group, if this is the entire genome of the virus right here, the green arrows depict what are called the immediate early genes. The immediate early genes are the first group of genes expressed, and they basically make regulatory proteins that modify the cell's transcriptional machinery and enable it to actually recognize the rest of this piece of DNA as a template to make RNA off of. So then, once that environment in this infected cell is modified, you make a suite of early messenger RNAs that encode the enzymes that you need for DNA replication. And once this DNA starts undergoing replication or amplification, then you express the rest of the proteins, many of which are the structural proteins that make the particle. So what does that look like? You have the initial, this is actually an HIV variant. It's not really herpes simplex virus, but whatever. It's a nice picture, so I used it. Anyway, you have a variant that is binding to a receptor on the surface of a cell that's about to be infected. It lets in the genetic material that goes to the nucleus, and there you make your immediate early proteins. And they create the environment that allows you to start making your replication proteins, your early proteins, and now you're starting to replicate DNA. Once you're starting to replicate DNA, you start amplifying that nucleic acid, and you start making lots of the components of the virion. And so one infectious particle came in, and here you see an infectious particle leaving. If we put this a little bit more to scale, this is actually a picture of an HSV-1 virion scaled relative to the relative size of a typical cell. And here are the progeny that are produced. One goes in, 100 comes out. So that is that process of viral replication is a major focus of virology textbooks. I think an easier way to appreciate what it really means is simply to watch the virus spreading through cells. Because really all viral replication is the virus spreading from cell to cell. So here we have a herpes simplex virus coming in that expresses a marker called green fluorescent protein that allows us to see this one cell that has the infection and is surrounded by other cells that are at this time point, 8 hours after infection, these cells are uninfected. So the question is, what happens over the next 48 hours? So we're gonna look at a little movie. You watch that over time, this is over the course of 2 days, you'll see that one cell is releasing all those little virions that are then going to adjacent cells and propagating the infection. The time is shown down here. So just within 36 hours, there is a massive amplification of the amount of virus. Okay, and that is what in an animal, within an animal, what would cause the infection to spread. So that's all viral replication boils down to. It's how the thing moves. each cell receives one infectious variant, and it's going to release at least 10 infectious variants and propagate the infection. So now that you've talked about the basic biology of viral replication, let's look at how the same virus spreads in an actual animal, because it's a little bit different in an animal than it is in a cell culture dish. So in this experiment, it's a pretty simple experiment, we're going to take three groups of mice. The first group of mice have a normal immune system. They haven't been treated with anything really nasty. The second group of animals and the third group of animals are both immunosuppressed. Their immune system is not working. The second group of animals in the middle, it's sort of like they're living next door to Chernobyl. They have been gamma irradiated. It messes up the bone marrow, so the immune system sort of crashes. The gamma radiation is not fatal, but what it does to the immune system creates a condition that makes infection with HSV, which would normally not be that big of a deal for these mice, a fatal infection. And likewise, cyclophosphamide is like the equivalent of chemotherapy. It just wipes out all rapidly dividing cells in the body, including cells of your immune system. And all three of these groups of mice, immunocompetent and immunocompromised, are gonna be exposed to that same green herpes simplex virus that we saw before. So what happens? If we look in the eye, so in this case, we're scratching the eye with a needle at time zero, and we're applying the virus to the scratches. And you can see 24 hours later, there's lots of cells in the eye of this mouse. This is the cornea of the mouse. And all those areas of green are active sites of viral replication. If we pull back to the level, the whole mouse, 3 days after infection of the eye, things are pretty quiet, a little bit going on here, but pretty quiet overall. This is the immunocompetent animal shown here. Here's the animals that have problems with their immune system. On day 4 and day 5, we start to see lots of little green spots coming up all over the nose. And if you remember that pattern I showed you with shingles, when it comes up, looks a lot like shingles. We call this zosteriform spread. The way it's happening is the virus enters through the eye, that is true. It goes back into the trigeminal ganglia, that is true. But there's nothing saying when the trigeminal ganglion neurons start shipping virus back down that it has to come back to the eye. Those trigeminal ganglion neurons innervate the entire face. And so these different spots you're seeing come up are different neurons that innervate different parts of the face where the virus is being shipped down to these spots and then it starts spreading. You'll notice in the immunosuppressed animal, the green spots are bigger because the immune system isn't working as well. And that becomes really apparent when you get 6 and 7 days out. The immunocompetent animal, all of them survive this infection. This is a pretty low virulent strain of HSV1. These immunosuppressed animals are not controlling the infection at all. And not only is it spreading down to the face such that we have to stop the experiment day 9, it's also spreading back into the nervous system. These animals are starting to have symptoms of encephalitis and need to be sacrificed. The normal animals with their immune system working, they're fine. So, what do I want you to get out of this? Two things. When you're thinking about the way herpes simplex virus spreads in the body, you have to remember the nervous system is its conduit of spread. Just because somebody gets genital herpes on, say in their labia, does not mean that it is impossible for that virus to go to their backbone and then come back in their buttocks or their legs. That actually happens all the time. Not widely recognized by clinicians, but that pattern of zosteriform spread is not unique to mice. It happens in human beings too. And for that matter, there's nothing saying the virus can't spread higher in the spine and come out another ganglia, maybe above the belt line. All these things are possible. Less likely to happen if someone's immune system's doing its job, but for people who are immunocompromised, these atypical or unusual patterns of herpes spread happen because the virus is not initially contained. And that is the second point of this. Again, this is not a cartoon or pretend thing that the way herpes simplex virus behaves is in equilibrium. All of the data collected over the last 50 years say that the host immune response is absolutely the brakes in this virus. And when you take it away through gamma radiation or cyclophosphamide, what was initially or should have been sort of a non-event, that is the animal should have survived this exposure. Animals with no immune systems do not survive exposure to this virus because they cannot tell the virus it's time for it to establish latency. All right, so now with that, we can go into what happens in humans. What typically happens in the case of HSV1 is we think of someone, you know, typically a small child before 6 years of age getting a kiss from grandma and there's a little something extra in there and you set up a replication or a site of viral replication in the mouth, maybe a break in the skin. And the virus amplifies there, and it gets into the nerve fibers, it innervates that site, and it's carried back up here to where the neuronal cell bodies are in the trigeminal ganglia, and there the virus undergoes replication again. And these neurons produce more infectious virus that can then spread deeper into the nervous system back towards the brain, hence creating the possibility of encephalitis. I will point out in human beings, it is a very rare complication. It does not normally happen. And you can also have round trip spread to other areas of the face or back to where the virus came in. All of this happens. Around the time the virus is getting to this point in infection, 5 days into the infection, this is exactly the same time the immune system is really getting engaged in going after this virus. So what you tend to see is by 7 days after infection in experimental animals, it becomes really difficult to find any infectious virus. It's quite abundant 4 or 5 days after infection, but by day seven, it's largely gone. It's very hard to detect. You are now entering into the latent phase of the virus life cycle. And this coincides precisely with the time that T cells and other white blood cells infiltrate the trigeminal ganglia. So it is not coincidence, which is why when you compromise the immune system of a host and you don't get that infiltration, you don't get the control. By 2 weeks after infection, what you're left with are little circular DNA molecules, episomes, in the neurons, that is in the nucleus of neurons, and they will hang out there for life. You will have a reservoir of latent infections. Later in life, you can be exposed to some of the things that are known to trigger reactivation, sunburn, fever, exam stress. That can reawaken this latent piece of DNA to reinitiate the productive cycle of replication. You make more infectious virus particles that get shipped back down. This can lead most commonly to asymptomatic shedding of infectious virus without symptoms. But if the immune response is slow to engage the virus down here in the skin, a week later you can have a cold sore. But in between reactivation in the neuron and the appearance of a lesion in the skin, there's usually 2 or 3 days of shedding asymptomatically infectious virus. So people without herpes symptoms can actually transmit the infection not knowing it. And the vast majority of reactivation events that start up here in the neurons only lead to asymptomatic shedding without any lesions at all. So now I want to focus on the other presentations of herpes, because again, too often doctors are taught HSV-1 causes cold sore and HSV-2 causes genital herpes, and that's pretty much it. And yes, HSV-2 has some strange tropism for the genitals that we don't understand, and HSV-1 is a similar tropism for the lips that we don't understand. And the simple reality is this is not true. It never was true. We just said it was true so many times that we confused ourselves. The simple reality is that here's a condition called herpes gladiatorium. Here's the reality. When guys wrestle, they bite each other. And if they're shedding infectious HSV-1 at the time of that bite, you can get, basically just like a cold sore, you can get herpes firing up in the elbow or the knee or wherever the bite was, and it'll reactivate and keep coming back to that site. That's where it went in, that's where it comes back. Likewise, you can get these steriform patterns of spread, and some people have genital herpes. Probably the initial site of infection was, you know, in the genital region, but it went up to the lower backbone. The lower backbone, those ganglia send neuronal fibers down to the buttocks. And if it comes back in a group like this, you'll get something that looks like shingles, but it's caused by HSV-1 or HSV-2. Probably this is HSV-2 with this large sites of lesions. Herpetic Whitlow. Dentists used to get this all the time. They stick their fingers in the patient's mouths. This is before they started using gloves all the time. And if they had a break in their nail, or you know, the skin between their nail and their finger, if a person was shedding HSV-1 and got into that cut, it would start up an infection here and it would keep coming back here. That's herpetic Whitlow. Same basic biology, all these. The last one is ocular herpes. Most people who suffer from ocular herpes typically will report that at the time they got it as a 2 or 3 year old is coincident with them getting their first fever blister or cold sore. And they had a scratch in their eye. Maybe they ran into a plant or a tree or something, but there was some sort of scratch in their cornea, and they rubbed it, and they took the virus mechanically. You know, they rubbed their mouth, got virus in their finger, rubbed their eye, and they impregnated their eye with HSV-1, and that's where it recurs. This is the most common cause of infectious blindness in developed countries, because unlike the rest of the body, the cornea, in order to remain clear, the cells have to be organized in a very precise way. If you have reactivations and healing of those lesions, it tends to cause the cornea to cloud over to the point where the person simply can't see through their cornea. So in all these cases, it's the same basic biology. It doesn't matter if it's ocular herpes or herpes gladiatorium or Whitlow or genital herpes, it's always the same thing. Virus gets into an epithelial site, it doesn't matter where. It undergoes amplification there, infects the nerve fibers that innervate that site, and it's carried back to the ganglia that sends nerve fibers to that location. Statistically speaking, the vast majority of these transmission events are either going to affect the mouth or the genitals, but these other complications happen too. But it's the same basic biology. It's just a matter of which specific ganglia of the spine is where the virus goes late. All right, that's alpha herpes viruses as they actually exist in vivo. So now let's talk about the immune response that controls them.